It's good to see you. Great to be together tonight. I want to thank some volunteers. There's many people who have made this event happen. I want to especially thank Anina Minotto, who took all of your registrations, has been very active for the last several weeks in helping prepare this event. Thank you, Anina. And her daughter was also very active. And Christina Honschel does what Christina does so well. Thank you, Christina. And Marilyn Kaufman, also selling books. Thank you to anybody's name who's not mentioned. You are very appreciated. And with that, I think we are ready. So I want to welcome back to the podium this evening for the second presentation, Mysticism, Empowerment, and Resistance. Please welcome again Dr. Marcus Borg.
Well, good evening to all of you. I think the microphone's working fine. I sound a little bit like the voice of God to myself, and I always enjoy that. So, I want to start tonight with just a couple of questions that call for a raising of hands. How many of you heard me this morning? Okay, most of you. And how many of you are... this is a separate question now. How many of you are visitors to All Saints? Okay, so most of you are All Saints. All right, great. Well, nice to be with you again. And, oops, need to reset my timer here. There we go. And I thought I would start off tonight with something a little bit lighthearted. I want to share with you, and there's some risk in doing this because this is out there on the internet, so you may have run into it. And it's mostly cute as opposed to profound. These are bloopers that have appeared in church bulletins or in announcements made in church. A whole series of them. The fasting and prayer conference includes meals. The sermon this morning, Jesus walks on the water. This evening sermon, searching for Jesus. Ladies, don't forget the rummage sale. It's a chance to get rid of those things not worth keeping around the house. Bring your husbands. Another one. Don't let worry kill you off. Let the church help. Miss Charlene Mason sang, "I Will Not Pass This Way Again," giving obvious pleasure to the congregation. Irving Benson and Jesse Carter were married on October 24th in the church. So ends a friendship that began in their school days. At the evening service tonight, the sermon topic will be, "What is Hell?" Come early and listen to our choir practice. Just a few more. The church will host an evening of fine dining, super entertainment, and gracious hostility. Low self-esteem support group will meet Thursday at 7 p.m. Please use the back door. <clears throat> Weight Watchers will meet at 7 p.m. at the First Presbyterian Church. Please use large double door at the side entrance. Two more. The eighth graders will be presenting Shakespeare's Hamlet in the church basement Friday at 7. The congregation is invited to attend this tragedy. And finally, Here we are. The ladies of the church have cast off clothing of every kind. You know what's coming, yeah. They may be seen in the basement on Friday afternoon. Okay. And now, beginning to move into the evening, I have prepared handouts for my talk tonight and also for my talk tomorrow night. And I do that for two reasons. One is obvious, to make it as easy as possible for you to follow what I'm saying and when I'm done, to see it whole. And also because my vocational passion, the reason I keep going on the road, is adult theological re-education at the parish level. And so I like to make what I have to say as portable as possible, as transportable as possible. So if there's anything on the handout that is useful to you in your own educational setting, and I'm aware that most of you are part of All Saints, so it's not like you're going to be spores on the wind, okay? Nevertheless, I encourage you to borrow shamelessly, okay? And last kind of introductory comment, format, we have until 7:30. I think my presentation will take until approximately 7 o'clock, so we'll have the last half hour for some Q&A, some interaction. And I make the transition now to my evening talk with a prayer from the Jewish tradition. And because it's relatively brief, I'm going to read it through twice. Days pass, and the years vanish, and we walk sightless among miracles. God, fill our eyes with seeing and our minds with knowing. Let there be moments when your presence, like lightning, illumines the darkness in which we walk. Help us to see wherever we gaze that the bush burns unconsumed. And we, clay touched by God, will reach out for holiness and exclaim in wonder, how filled with awe is this place, and we did not know it. And once again, days pass and the years vanish and we walk sightless among miracles. God, fill our eyes with seeing and our minds with knowing. Let there be moments when your presence, like lightning, illumines the darkness in which we walk. Help us to see wherever we gaze that the bush burns unconsumed. And we, clay touched by God, we'll reach out for holiness and exclaim in wonder, how filled with awe is this place, and we did not know it. Amen. So I turn to my talk this evening, Mysticism, Empowerment, Resistance, and Counter-Advocacy. Quite a mouthful. And there are two main parts to my talk. In part one, I seek to describe what mysticism and mystical experiences are, and then in part two, why they matter, whether we ourselves have had such an experience or not. So I turn to part one, and I begin with some clarification of terms. In today's English, mysticism and its siblings, mystic and mystical experience, often have negative connotations. They refer to something vague, fuzzy, that need not be taken seriously, or sometimes amongst religious people, they are seen as kind of escapist and not really connected to the real world. I think we all, perhaps, have heard somebody say in a dismissive way, "Sounds mystical to me." So also in much of Protestantism, to illustrate with words from two of the theological giants of the 20th century, the first being Reinhold Niebuhr, probably the most important American-born theologian of the 20th century. He once defined mysticism as beginning in mist, centered in I, and ending in schism. And I take it that's negative. Karl Barth, arguably one of the two most important Protestant theologians of the 20th century, in his multi-volume Church Dogmatics, treated mysticism under the category of atheism, because he saw mystics as basically denying the God of the biblical tradition. And it's also negatively viewed by many conservative evangelical Protestants. A quick example, three or four years ago now, a book that I enjoyed very much on prayer, that correlated prayer, mystical experience, and neuroscience, by an evangelical author named Ken Wilson, called Mystically Wired, and published by an evangelical publishing house, most Christian bookstores would not carry it. And that's in part because most Christian bookstores are conservative evangelical, and it's also because the word mystical appeared in the title. They thought it belonged in the occult. In the academic world, it's not so much a negative term as an ambiguous term. Some scholars define mysticism very narrowly and see it primarily as a phenomenon of the Middle Ages in both Christianity and Judaism, and thus view it as relatively rare, and hence not very important. Others define it more broadly and see it as foundational to the religions of the world. I use the broad definition myself in words from the handout. Mysticism is about union or communion with the sacred. Mystical experiences are ecstatic experiences of God, or synonyms, the sacred, reality, or the most generic term imaginable, isness. And I'll say more about some of those words in a moment. And to show the antiquity of this broad definition, I turn to medieval Christianity, and I'm going to do the definition in Latin so that you all feel properly educated as well as that you're getting your money's worth. Mysticism is the cognitio experimentalis Dei. And you can probably figure out the English from the Latin Cognitio, cognition, knowing. Experimentales, experiential. And Dei, of course, God. Mysticism is the experiential knowledge of God. For people who have these experiences, God or the sacred is not simply an article of belief, but a reality known. Mystics are people who have an overwhelming sense of knowing God. These experiences range from glimmerings to deeply ecstatic, and they are memorable. If you've had a mystical experience, you don't forget it. And if you wonder whether you've ever had a mystical experience, you probably haven't. It's kind of like wondering if you've ever had an orgasm. To move beyond that very brief definition to the classic definition provided by William James in his book, published over 100 years ago now and still in print, The Varieties of Religious Experience. By the way, back in 1999, when various lists were being compiled of the most important 100 whatever of the 20th century, one of those lists combined by a group of scholars was the 100 most important nonfiction books originally published in English in the 20th century. Number two on that list was James's Varieties of Mystical Experience. According to that book, and by the way, that book is not primarily speculative. I mean, yes, every book in a sense is speculative. You learn what the author thinks. But James based what he had to say on his own research with people who had mystical experiences. Some of it firsthand interviews, some of it based on research of literature written by mystics. And based on that, James concluded that mystical experiences have two primary features common to all of them and in a sense defining them. The first of these, a sense of union, a sense of connectedness with God, the sacred, with what is. And James, seeking a generic name for what is experienced, called what is experienced a more. Now you can do a word play on that. Amore, okay? I mean, in a way, what is experienced is amore, but don't go down the road of love right now. Stick with a more. And this experience of union or communion involves a non-ordinary state of consciousness. You could say an altered state of consciousness, and that would be accurate as well, but because that phrase is so often used in connection with drug experiences, I'm going to use a non-ordinary state of consciousness. They are ecstatic, a word whose roots clearly indicate what the word means, a state of consciousness other than ordinary everyday consciousness. Ecstasy, its Greek roots, first syllable is a preposition meaning out of, stasis, a state of being. To be ecstatic is to be out of your ordinary state of being. And they involve, and again, it's a bit of a mouthful, but if you'll stick with me, I think it'll be relatively clear what I'm talking about. They involve a momentary disappearance of the self-world distinction of what might be called ego separation or the boundaried self, briefly to explain. In our ordinary state of consciousness, which presumably you're all in right now, if I've triggered a mystical experience for anybody, praise the Lord, okay. In our ordinary state of consciousness, and let me use first person pronoun, it's easier, I experience myself as in here. And you and the world as out there. Now, in a seriously acute state, that can become a state of profound alienation, as in the title of Sylvia Plath's book, The Bell Jar, where it's as if in that state of serious alienation, it's as if you're living inside of a jar from which all of the air has been removed and everything is out there and you're virtually suffocating in your alienation. But in ordinary, less extreme form, it's just how we experience the world. This is also called the world of the subject hyphen object distinction. Even our grammar reflects it. I, subject, verb, see, you, object. Once again, I'm in here, you're out there. Now, in mystical experiences, this sense of separation vanishes or becomes very soft. To use an image, in our ordinary state of consciousness, it's as if we live within the dome of the ego. Some of you are old enough to remember that Colgate toothpaste advertisement. An invisible guard all shield, okay? In mystical experiences, that dome of the ego falls away or becomes very porous, and we are far more aware of our connectedness to everything than we are of our differentiation. The second primary feature is a sense, again, according to James, his language, a sense of illumination. Sometimes this literally involves an experience of light, and I'll say more about that in a moment. But it's not just that it can literally involve an experience of the light changing. It also creates a sense of enlightenment, of seeing anew, of having one's eyes opened. The language of mysticism is full of images of light and seeing and knowing, and the opposites of darkness, blindness, and not knowing. Mystics see differently. They see reality, the world, and their lives differently. To carry on with this attempt to describe what these experiences are like, there are two primary kinds or categories of mystical experiences. And this is from scholarship since James wrote his book. Two primary kinds, extrovertive and introvertive. Huge categories, of course, but helpful. Extrovertive mystical experiences, described only slightly differently, mean eyes open mystical experiences. Here, you see the same thing you'd be seeing in any case. The same room full of people, the same landscape, the same person. You're not seeing the Virgin Mary or angels or anything extra, but everything looks different. Very often, everything seems suffused with light, as if light is shining through everything, but not in such a way that everything becomes transparent. It's almost as if everything glows. This is such a common feature of eyes open mystical experiences that Mircea Eliade, for many decades professor of comparative religions at the University of Chicago, and probably the most important scholar of comparative religions of the 20th century and therefore ever. They weren't really around in the 19th and 18th centuries, okay? So common is this experience of light, oftentimes yellow or orange or lemony, that Eliade called them experiences of the golden world. Or to use a biblical expression from Isaiah, the whole earth is filled with the glory of God. And in the Bible, the word glory oftentimes means radiance or luminosity. Extrovertive mystical experiences are experiences when you see what is right in front of your face become radiant, luminous. The other primary category is introvertive mystical experiences. These are eyes closed mystical experiences. And again, the language is meant literally here. Sometimes they include visions, but also non-visionary experiences. A sense of the presence of the sacred, sometimes in the silence of contemplative prayer. Finally, four additional features according to James. Ineffability. He means by this something very simple. It's really hard to put these experiences into words. People who have these experiences almost invariably end up saying things like, it was like. Words can only stammer and stutter as they try to talk about these experiences. In 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 4, Paul speaks of a mystical experience, almost certainly his own, though he describes it in the third person. I know a man in Christ who ascended into the third heaven, and there he heard things that are unutterable. And I don't think Paul meant, I could tell you, but I made a promise not to. He meant, they're beyond all language. Second feature, transiency, meaning they are brief, sometimes a few seconds, less often perhaps a few minutes, very rarely a few hours. Thirdly, that is, they come and they go, okay? Thirdly, passivity. When I first ran into this in James some 30 years ago or so, I thought, well, what does this mean? And then I figured out it means something really quite simple. You can't make them happen. You receive them. You receive them, as it were, in a passive state. They come upon you. And fourth and finally, and very importantly, again to use James's word, they are noetic. It's an unfamiliar word to the majority of us, I suspect. But what he meant by that is that people who have these experiences speak of them as a knowing and not just as a strong feeling or an ecstatic feeling of joy, but they feel that they came to know something through that experience that they didn't know before. And what they know is the way things are. not in some dogmatic sense that can be put into words, but there is this sense of seeing more clearly and fully than you ever have in your life. So that's my attempt to characterize what these experiences are like. And I turn now to part two, why mysticism matters. I begin with, well, the first point, okay? Mystical experiences are foundational to the world's religions. To illustrate this with names you're all familiar with, within Judaism and Christianity, the most central figures of the Bible are portrayed as people who had experiences of the sacred. And the three most central figures, of course, are Moses, Jesus, and Paul. The stories about them all speak of them having had dramatic experiences of God, very oftentimes associated with their call. But the basic point is they are portrayed as people who knew the sacred, not just as people who believed strongly in God. And then add to that, just a partial list, some of the less central figures, Abraham, Jacob, Elijah, Amos, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Mary Magdalene, Peter, the author of Revelation. And then moving beyond Judaism and Christianity, the Buddha, of course, had an enlightenment experience under the Bo tree that profoundly changed him and began his 45-year-long vocation as a teacher. And of course, Muhammad is portrayed as a mystic. In his case, the mystical experiences seem to have been auditions, words, rather than visions. The founders, or every founder, let me put it that way, of a major religion about whom we know anything is portrayed as a mystic. And then beyond the founding figures, moving back to Christianity, formative figures in post-biblical Christianity, again, a partial list, Augustine, Francis of Assisi, Julian of Norwich, Hildegard of Bingen, Catherine of Siena, Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, Martin Luther, George Fox, John Wesley, and that is by no means a complete list. Once again, all had mystical experiences that profoundly changed them. And moving beyond famous names, Eastern Orthodoxy is the most mystical stream of Christianity. It's kind of taken for granted within Eastern Orthodoxy that of course you will have mystical experiences. And this is one of the major purposes of the shape and texture of Orthodox worship. And the primary image for salvation within Eastern Orthodoxy is enlightenment, which again is a thoroughly mystical term. And then I note that mystical experiences have nurtured the lives of ordinary Christians for centuries. We have no idea what percentage of ordinary Christians, meaning the people whose names nobody knows anymore and so forth. We have no idea what percentage of them may have had experiences that seemed overwhelmingly to them to be experiences of God. I know of two studies of contemporary North Americans. Both studies suggest that roughly a third of adult Americans have had at least one mystical experience. And the studies also point out that most people don't know to call it a mystical experience. They will simply say I had this extraordinary experience. There is some reason to think that our ancestors, let's say prior to 1850 or so, may have had mystical experiences more frequently than we in the modern world do. I don't want to overly detail that, but in the last 100 years, maybe 150 years, depending upon the part of the country and so forth, we have basically, in modern Western cultures, moved inside. You know, we live in houses, and they aren't just for shelter from the storm. We spend most of our time inside. We typically work inside. If we travel somewhere, we travel inside of something. Another quick example, so that's an insulation from nature. Another example, light pollution. In metropolitan areas in this country, and not just megalopolises like where we are right now, but even in a town of 30,000, 50,000 people, if you go out and look at the night sky, you'll see maybe 25 stars. We've also domesticated the night in the last 100 to 150 years. Imagine what the world was like before electric lights. I'm not trying to be romantic about the past. I'm just pointing to obvious changes in relatively recent human history. Or one more example. Imagine the experience of farming 150 years ago or so, when there were, you know, to say the obvious, there were no motors. All labor was done by animals or human beings. Imagine the experience of harvesting with a sigh. That rhythmic motion, back and forth, with no sound except the sound of nature around you. Now, I'm not making a case for back to the past. There are very hard things about the past. But just that the conditions of modern life may impede mystical experience. A little aside here, I won't go on about this too long. My brother-in-law was a wheat farmer, and his combine, wow, it had air conditioning. It had a beer cooler. It had a superb sound system. Now, if I were a wheat farmer, I'd probably want the same thing. So I'm not faulting him. But contrast that experience with the world before motorized machinery. Last comment in this section. Not all Christians have mystical experiences, and that's okay. There is no pecking order here, where people who have had mystical experiences are somehow more spiritually advanced than people who haven't. This is one of the points that Paul makes in 1 Corinthians 12 through 14, when he talks about the spiritual gifts and how it's important not to value one of them more than another. But probably my favorite way of making this point is with the story of Jesus appearing to Thomas in the 20th chapter of John. We commonly call Thomas Doubting Thomas, that Thomas, okay? And when I was growing up, Thomas was not a role model. You know, the only thing worse than being a doubting Thomas was probably to be a Judas. But as I have spent time with that story over the decades, I realized that there's no condemnation of Thomas in that story. The story doesn't say, Thomas, you shouldn't have doubted. The way the story goes is on the evening of Easter Sunday, Jesus appears to 10 of the disciples in an upper room in Jerusalem. Judas, of course, is out of the picture by now. Thomas isn't there. We don't know why. Did he get caught in traffic? I mean, who knows, you know? And so the 10, later that week, tell Thomas what has happened. And Thomas says, unless I see with my own eyes and touch with my own hands, I cannot and will not believe. What Thomas desired was his own firsthand experience. And it is granted to him a few days later. And in that scene, again, there's no condemnation of Thomas for desiring that experience. And the scene concludes with the risen Christ saying to Thomas, do you believe because you have seen? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. I actually prefer the verb belove there. I think it catches the ancient meaning better. It's okay to desire your own firsthand experience, but whether you have one or not, blessed are you if you belove Jesus. Second point under why mysticism matters. Mystical experiences are the most compelling reason to take the reality of God or the sacred seriously. Because these experiences happen, they suggest a more, a non-material level or layer of reality that pervades all that is and can sometimes be occasionally experienced. Without mystical experiences, the notion of God remains a hypothesis, a possibility that you can argue for or argue against or believe in or not believe. And as a hypothesis, the notion of God, quite frankly, is not very compelling. Karl Rahner, arguably the most important Roman Catholic theologian from the second half of the 20th century, in one of his books, in more than one place actually, said, the Christianity of the future will be mystical, or it will not be at all. Christianity has had a long run in the West because it was part of the taken for granted conventional understanding of the way things are. But once that taken for granted conventional understanding is no longer in place, then if Christianity does not have an experiential basis, it will have no future. Another reason connected to the notion of God is that mystical experiences affect our understanding of the referent of the word God, of what we are thinking of or imagining when we hear that word or use that word. Namely, from what is oftentimes called in shorthand supernatural theism to another shorthand term, panentheism. Briefly to explain, supernatural theism as a phrase is shorthand for a very common way of thinking about God. That the word God refers to a person-like being, separate from the universe, who created the universe a long time ago as something separate from God's self, and who relates to the universe primarily through intervention, which is the only way a person-like being who is separate from the universe can relate to the universe. This is the God whom the contemporary best-selling books on atheism attack and reject. Candidly, I agree with them. I am an atheist with regard to that way of thinking about God. I began to have problems with that way of thinking about God when I was 12 or 13. And they didn't go away. No matter how much I prayed that they would go away. And it was only, I was a slow learner, it was only in my 30s that I realized that there is a very different way of understanding the referent of the word God. This is panentheism. Note the middle syllable, en. It's a Greek preposition. And it distinguishes panentheism from pantheism. Pantheism, without that syllable, is the affirmation that everything that is God, is sacred. That the sum total of everything is what is meant by the word God. Panentheism means everything is in God. That the word God refers to more than everything, that is, more than the space-time world of matter and energy, refers to more than that, but the space-time world of matter and energy is in God. And of course, when you think about it, we were kind of taught this as kids. You know, most of us heard not only that God is up in heaven, but that God is everywhere. And for panentheism, we are in God like fish are in water. Now, of course, the water is in the fish, but it's more important to the fish, actually, that the fish is in the water, you know? The fish may not even know it's in the water until it gets yanked out. Then it might say, oh my God, but anyway. And my point being, if, as the mystics suggest, God or the sacred can be experienced, then God is not far off, but right here, all around us. And when we talk about God, we're not talking about a supernatural being who may or may not exist, but about a glorious, radiant, luminous mystery that is right here and sometimes glimpsed, experienced. Next point, mystical experiences, transformation, and empowerment. If one has a single mystical experience, it might not change you very much, even though you're unlikely to forget it. But for people who have very vivid or perhaps frequent mystical experiences, it profoundly changes the way you see what is, the way you understand the way things are. God becomes very real, and this can become an extraordinary source of empowerment or courage. Let me give you just one example of courage right now, and I'll talk more about empowerment in just a moment, though they're not all that distinct. All Lutherans, I grew up Lutheran, all Lutherans know the story of Martin Luther at the Diet of Worms. Many Protestants do too, but I'll review the story for you. And now I can't remember if it's 1520 or 1521, but to fit the chronology, in 1517, Luther, in effect, begins the Protestant Reformation with the 95 Theses. And he begins to speak against the Catholic Church and publish pamphlets, some of them 20, 30 pages long, against the oppression of the Catholic Church and so forth. And finally, in either 1520 or 1521, what's called an imperial diet is convened. The word diet simply means something like council. And Luther is ordered to appear before this imperial council to answer charges brought by a representative of the Pope, charges of heresy. And the scene unfolds over a couple of days, but radically to condense it. Luther is asked if he would be willing to recant everything he has written and said against the Catholic Church, which means basically to take back, to disavow. And he asks for time to think about it overnight so he can pray about it. Great response, by the way. Let me pray about it. And the next day he appears again. He's asked the same question. And this time he says, by the way, the threat is excommunication. And excommunication in those days, really, really different from getting tossed out of All Saints. Okay. Not only did excommunication carry with it, in the minds of many people, the threat of eternal punishment, because salvation was possible only within the church, but if you had been excommunicated, you were outside of the law, and anybody could kill you without having to answer to the law. Plus, you could be burned at the stake. So, I mean, this is no small matter. And Luther says, unless I am convinced by evident reason and scripture, I cannot and will not recant. Here I stand, I can do no other. The here I stand part is the part that all Lutherans know. And then the representative of the Pope leans forward and says, by the way, imagine the courage it took to say that, okay? Then the representative of the Pope leans forward and says, and Brother Martin, if Holy Mother Church should excommunicate you, where will you stand then? This is the part of the story that not many people know. And Luther said, under God's blue sky. Something that mystics know which is why the church has often distrusted them, is that no institution has a monopoly on access to God. God can be known, experienced, and that can become a source of enormous empowerment and courage. And carrying directly on from that, mystical experiences resistance and counter-advocacy, again, a mouthful. Very simply, the major figures of the Bible resisted the domination systems of their time, the political and religious powers of their time, and not only resisted them, but were advocates of God's passion for a different kind of world. Again, think of the three primary figures for Christians, Moses. Think of the courage it took to be Moses and challenge Pharaoh. And of course, it was not only about resisting the political and economic oppression of Pharaoh, but it was also about Moses being an advocate of God's dream for a different way of putting human community together, and out of that you get covenant and so forth. Same thing with the prophets of ancient Israel, and I'll detail that tomorrow night. And then Jesus. Again, think of the courage it took to be Jesus. Going to Jerusalem, knowing almost certainly that the religious and political powers who ruled his world would snuff him out. And yet he's a vocal critic of those powers and an advocate of the kingdom of God, which is for the earth and which is about the transformation of this world into God's dream of a world of justice and the end of violence. And so also, though I won't detail it right now, with Paul, who proclaimed, I guess I'm going to a little bit, one of Paul's bumper stickers is, Jesus is Lord. And in that world, as most of you know, Lord was one of the titles of Caesar. It would be like a German Christian in the 1930s during the Third Reich walking around with a t-shirt that says, and I'll do it in English, Jesus is my Führer. Courage, resistance, and advocacy of a different way of putting the world together. A side comment here. The idea for talking about this came to me about 10 years ago after reading a wonderful book by a German-American theologian named Dorothy Soele. I did that wrong, Soele, S-O-E-L-L-E, in German, S-U-M-L-A-U-T-O-L-L-E. Wonderful author. And this book, I think it bears an unfortunate title, The Silent Cry. It's evocative, but it doesn't tell you what the book is about. But the subtitle does. The subtitle is Mysticism and Resistance. And what the book is about is a direct challenge to the notion that mysticism and a kind of otherworldliness go together. And so she tracks throughout the history of the Christian tradition the mystics who have become voices of resistance against the humanly created world of injustice and violence. Almost done. An important qualification. Some mystical experiences are diabolical. Now, this is James's word again, diabolical. And And he means by it that if an experience like this leads to disintegration of the personality, or to perhaps saying the same thing, an abiding psychotic state, then it's not of God. Soli, in the book that I just mentioned, makes a similar point. She talks about how when she was, I don't know, in her 30s or 40s, doesn't really matter, but when people who were adults during the Hitler years were still alive, I mean, they would have been 30 or 40, probably max, during the Hitler years. And she talked about interviewing them about the Hitler rallies, especially the Nuremberg rallies. And she said the way they described them, these were mystical experiences for them. The disappearance of a sense of being a separate self, sense of connectedness with the folk, an ecstatic experience. And they would regularly say to her, "You had to be there." It's easy for me to imagine that one or more of the 9/11 hijackers might have been in an ecstatic state of consciousness as those airliners spent their last minute or 30 seconds in the air before impacting the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. And so ecstasy by itself is no guarantee that this is of God. And so James, very much aware of this, suggests that the test, the criterion for distinguishing a mystical experience that is of the spirit from one that is diabolical is the same test reported in a saying of Jesus in Matthew's gospel, "By their fruits you shall know them." If the fruit of an alleged mystical experience is violence and brutality, or softer forms, arrogance and a sense of self-righteousness or privilege or something like that, it is almost certainly not of the spirit or has a huge amount of static in it. And that primary fruit of the spirit is love. That's Paul's language. Compassion is more Jesus' language, and a passion for God's world. And here, let me underline that the social form of love and compassion, which is utterly central to the Bible, is justice and peace. To conclude, the mystics, it seems to me, speak about our deepest yearnings. One of those yearnings is for a fuller connection to what is. I suspect a good number of you would say that the best moments in your life have been moments when you have experienced that sense of connectedness. It's a deep human yearning. And a second human yearning that runs deeply in most of us is that the world be a better place for our contemporaries, but perhaps especially when we think of our children and our grandchildren and so forth. And those two yearnings are what the mystics speak about. Thank you. (Clears throat) I'm going to suggest that we move into some interactive time in the following way. I'm going to suggest we take a minute's worth of silence so that you can make the transition, so that you can have your own mystical experience. No, so that you can make the transition from listening to me to giving a little bit of thought to what you might like to ask about or briefly comment about. And if you'd like to take a standing in place stretch break during that minute, I invite you to do so, and I'll let you know when the minute is up. Two procedural comments, and then we'll be underway. We have two roving microphones and two people carrying them who henceforth will be known as rovers. And if you want to ask a question, you need to attract the attention of one of the rovers. The rovers will do the selecting, not me. So you can wave all you want at me and nothing's going to happen. And secondly, I like to go for approximate gender balance. So rovers, listen up. The rovers will not call on more than two people from the same gender in a row. Okay? So I think we have somebody ready to go over here.
Given your comment about the difficulty of having mystical experiences in the modern era when we're indoors so much, are you an advocate of more outdoor Eucharists and outdoor religious experiences and general services?
Am I an advocate of outdoor experiences for youth groups in particular? Eucharist. Oh, not necessarily. I mean, to be outdoors in, well, let me use the city that I lived in most recently, Portland. You still got traffic noise. You still got jets overhead. I think I have nothing against outdoor Eucharist. I'm not sure that it's a big step, though. I think it would be great to teach very young children. I'm not talking about three-year-olds now. I don't know how far down I'd push it, but certainly elementary school children can learn contemplative prayer. Kathleen Norris, whose name many of you would recognize, has a page or two about this in one of her books when she was doing poetry in the schools. She's a poet, amongst other things. And she decided to see if, I don't know if it was third graders or fourth graders, could be comfortable with 5 minutes of silence, with her leading them into it and so forth. They loved it. And so I don't mean that teaching children contemplative prayer is the single solution to this, but simply helping people to become conscious of the importance of silence and of other spiritual practices. I don't know how you all do teze here. One of the things I hate about the way most American teze services are done, people sing so softly. And if you go to teze in France, the sound just overwhelms you, not because people are shouting, but they're singing their hearts out. Chant that you sing your hearts out to can create a kind of, I don't know, ambiance that is conducive to kind of losing yourself in this community of praise. So I'm picking up on your suggestion, but running with it a little bit, like, what kinds of things can we do in church, in worship, and so forth. But I also think teaching about this, not teaching it to death, but just that people are aware, oh my God, there are experiences like this, and oh my God, there are certain kinds of practices that can become the occasions for such experiences. And maybe church isn't primarily about words, 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 words. Oh, another pet peeve. You know, when you get to be 70, you can call your pet peeves convictions. Okay. And I don't want to pick on our mainline Protestant brothers and sisters overly much here, but I've probably been at about 300 churches for Sunday worship in the last 15 years, maybe a third of them Episcopal, but the other two-thirds Methodist, Presbyterian, UCC, few others. And I'm just dismayed by how the service is directed at the head. You know, sermons, a pastoral prayer that goes on for 6 or 7 minutes that somebody has worked hard to compose, so you have to pay attention to it. Scripture read at a very fast rate because we got a lot of stuff to cover today, and it's like hymns that are difficult to sing. Oy. You know, okay.
I have a question here.
Yes.
I wonder if you would mind putting two statements together that are on the second page. Under number two, Karl Rahner's statement, the Christianity of the future will be mystical or it will not be at all. Mm-hmm. Could you put that together with under number one, not all Christians have them, and that's okay. Mm. Does that imply that for the church to survive, according to Rahner, we'd better have the majority of people having mystical experiences?
You know, I don't know what Rahner would have said in response to your question. I think he would say, no, but if at the core or center of Christian community life, I'm getting a negative construction in here where I don't quite want it. I think he would say, at the core, at the center of the Christian life, should be a mystical sense of the reality and presence of God. And people who haven't had a mystical experience will at least know that there are people who have, and that they might also, and to use the Thomas text again, that they are blessed whether they've had one or not. So I think it's more, if you don't, I don't think he would say, if you don't have a mystical experience, then you won't be part of the church of the future. I'm pretty sure he would not go that way with it. But that you could say Buddhism is intrinsically a mystical experience. I'm sorry, a mystical religion. And I think Rahner would say Christianity needs to become that as well, or it doesn't have a future.
Over here. Regarding what you said earlier about the ineffable and the limitations on understanding these kinds of experiences, I wonder if you could speak to other constructs. For me, monasticism comes to mind as structure in which these experiences are somehow articulated, if not linguistically, at least there's a community that understands these kind of experiences to be what is truly real. What are other frameworks in which we can operate that can help us to understand or at least to acknowledge that these experiences are real in ourselves and in those people around us?
Mm-hmm. I think your example of monasticism is excellent, meaning the monastic life. And by the way, in Greek, monk is a gender-neutral term, so it intrinsically includes both women's orders and men's orders. But I think the monastic life is basically the attempt to make contemplation at the center of community life. And I think what we can learn from the monastic life is the importance of a spiritual discipline, which means simply a regular practice, and it might even be one somewhat tailor-designed, okay, rather than a standard one adopted from elsewhere in the dailiness of our lives. The importance of contemplative prayer, of retreats, of other traditional practices, journal keeping for some people. But I'm not really aware of other structures that that do what monasticism historically has been about. Obviously, there are things one can introduce into worship. I don't know how things are here at All Saints, but I think it would be great for a congregation to spend at least 5 minutes in silence together during a Sunday morning worship. And of course, they have to be educated about that. Otherwise, people are going to think, somebody's forgotten what's come next. I mean, or what's happening here, And so I don't know if I have a lot more to say about that, but the monastic example is excellent.
I have the microphone, but I'm going to mess up your gender ratio over here.
I'm sorry. Where are you?
Right here. Right here.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay.
Hi. I'm curious about why evangelical Christians have a negative attitude towards mysticism.
I guess I don't know. I only have some anecdotes. I didn't have a lot of evangelical students taking my classes during the decades that I taught, but I had some of them. And they would say things like their pastor had told them that if you practice contemplative prayer, meaning the prayer of internal silence, you don't know what kind of spirit might get in. And and there's a real fear of that in some of those circles. That, I think you're all aware that some evangelical Christians see the practice of yoga as demonic. Some of that is the fear that some other spirit might get in. Some of it is they associate meditation with other religious traditions and are historically ignorant of the fact that it's central to the Christian tradition, so they see it as introducing something non-Christian into the Christian tradition. Let me add one other thing. It sounds harsh. The United States has the least educated clergy of any developed country. Now, I'm not talking about mainline Protestants or Catholics. Those clergy all have not only undergraduate degrees, but typically 3 to 4 years of graduate school. But in independent Protestant churches, which are roughly half of American Protestants, in most of them, there's no educational requirement for ordination. And so these guys, and they're almost exclusively guys, can assume that the form of Christianity that they grew up in or that they got converted by is the only form of Christianity or the orthodox form of Christianity. And because anything like contemplative prayer or even chant is foreign to their background, they assume it's foreign to Christianity. If you've never had your provinciality challenged, you can know a lot of stuff for sure. And so some of it is just ignorance of the Christian tradition. You know? Oh, contemplative prayer. Mysticism. Oh, no. Yeah. So.
I know that there is a number of Buddhist, especially like Zen schools, that believe that, I guess, enlightenment, which you would classify as being a, you know, a mystical experience, people can be trained for it in large numbers, and they can achieve those states fairly reliably. Mm-hmm. Now, they, you know, usually that's not mixed in with, for example, attempts to improve the world, but the belief that they have that this can be done on an industrial scale, do you agree with it, disagree with it? Do you think it's desirable? Tell us what you think.
industrial scale. Anyway, I guess I do not know what a Buddhist teacher would say about how many years of intentional practice it would commonly take before one would have an enlightenment experience. I simply don't know. I don't know if they would say, well, if you do this for 20 years, you're probably going to. I do know that there's a strong emphasis in Buddhism that if you're grasping for the experience, you won't have it. So you have to yearn for the experience without wanting it. So I don't know. And I doubt that, well, let me put it differently. If somebody practices contemplative prayer, and I don't mean to suggest there's a magic number here, regularly, even, you know, 20 minutes a day, it's going to have an effect on you. Whether it'll produce a mystical experience is a separate question. I think James is right. You cannot actively make them happen. And anecdotally, I know stories of, you know, Buddhist monks who have been practicing in a monastery for 30 years and still they're not there, you know? So, I probably should stop since I don't know. Okay, we've got time for one or two more, especially if I don't know anything about them.
I'm of the wrong gender. I'm okay, even though I'm of the wrong gender. I got your book here on Jesus and Buddha, and I'm just looking at page 83. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And Buddha says anyone who withdraws into meditation on compassion can see Brahma with his own eyes and talk to him face to face and consult him. Now I think I've had a what you might call a mystical experience. When I was very strongly a meditator, I remember once going to a Buddhist meditation retreat for 10 days, and when I came out of it, the world seemed completely different. You know, it really opened my eyes. It seemed like a totally different place. But it faded. Mm-hmm. It faded within, you know, 4 or 5 hours of having left this retreat. One of the things that I guess my question comes is, you know, the mystical experience that I may have had, it didn't lead me to anything sort of to confront power or to confront what was there. It seems to me that the one thing that has always bothered me about Buddhism and why I've sort of rotated this way, is that it is not active in the world, and in terms of confronting the situations, it mm-hmm. tends to be pull away from.
Yeah.
And I wonder your thoughts on that.
Yeah, good, good. Two things that I would want to say. Historically, that's a pretty accurate criticism of Buddhism, that it has not had the passion for addressing injustice. I mean, it's been very good on the level of individual ethics, of being a compassionate individual. But confronting the powers has historically not been part of it. And I'm going to say a second thing in a moment, but I want to add to the first thing. A possible reason for that might be the social class of the Buddha compared to the social class of Moses, the prophets, and Jesus, just to use them as an example. They all experienced injustice firsthand. They were part of oppressed groups. And where you get a passion for justice, typically, is from the experience of injustice. The stories about the Buddha, and again, how much of it is historical, always hard to know, but he grew up in a state of high privilege. You know, I don't know if he technically was royalty, but from a very wealthy family and so forth. And if that's your social class, it may seem to you that the primary problem in life is individual enlightenment and not addressing the injustices of the world. Then the second comment, in the last half century, nice round number, something called engaged Buddhism, that's a phrase that's used, has emerged that is much more socially active. And the names you all would recognize immediately would be Thich Nhat Hanh and, of course, the Dalai Lama. But it's not just those two figures, but there's actually a movement within Buddhism known as engaged Buddhism, which is much more political. Do I have time for one more? I'll be brief. Okay.
Okay. You have mentioned mysticism as an experience.
Yeah.
I guess I'm wondering if you could comment on the notion that you could get to the point of having sort of a unitive consciousness or a non-dual consciousness or a mystical consciousness that is sort of a bit more pervasive as opposed to a sort of a mount of transfiguration type individual experience.
The experience of the mystics whom I've read, and that's quite a few, is that though the ecstatic state of consciousness is a transitory state, you don't live in it all of the time, that what you experience or learned in that state affects your ordinary state of consciousness. I don't know if this would be a helpful illustration or not. Most of you are familiar with research on near-death experiences. It's been in the air in this country since the late 1970s. And people who have had a near-death experience, meaning one of those that involves typically sense of going through a tunnel, a great light, feelings of joy, sometimes seeing your own body from a vantage point outside of your body. And of course, people who have near-death experiences, they all come back, right? but But most of those people will say it profoundly changed not only how they think of death, but how they live their lives, how they see on a day-to-day basis. And that's, I think, I doubt that even the Dalai Lama lives in a regular state of non-duality or whatever, you know. I mean, it's, I don't know, it's hard to drive a car if you're ego function is a good thing. It's the way we get around the world. Ego identity, I think, is, you know, that's that domed self and can become an excruciatingly lonely, alienated place. But ego function, which involves being aware that, you know, there's a stop sign there and I need to stop for it. It's a good thing. So, okay, kind of an, so last word for tonight, stop for stop signs. All right. Thank you very much.